Thank you, Father, for the great and mighty assurance. Thank you for your church. Thank you for this mystical body of Jesus Christ that you place here on earth, preparing men, women, boys, and girls for that celestial city. Thank you, Lord, that though she is despised and rejected, but you supervise her growth. And, oh God, you will never leave her nor forsake her. Thank you today, Lord, that she remained the church of the living God. I ask you to speak to her today. Speak to us today. Let your divine presence be upon us now as we worship you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You may be seated, please. Praise the Lord. We honor God for his presence. We honor him for his great mercy and his love. I thank God for our worship leader, Exalted Forest, leading our worship today. Amen. I honor God for ministering servant, Minister Reid, and for the entire ministerial staff, the leadership of the church, and those who are faithfully standing with us. I say to you today, God bless you. Amen. To all our listening friends, our members of the congregation, members of the church, God bless you. We certainly honor the Lord today for the blessing of the Lord upon this house. God is with us. Amen. I have every confidence that this is the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I will never doubt him. Praise God. God is with us and he's speaking to us. Let me be so grateful to God for the upcoming events and several events that are coming that are going to challenge our heart. Our encounter service on Saturday, the 3rd, the 4th. We have to be here to be challenged by God, and then our covenant members meeting, and of course our Give Me the Flowers, the second Sunday in March, one of those services that was always planned as a means of encouraging each other. We like to give the flowers to encourage. Someone says, well, give me the flower while I live. And that's exactly what we are doing. Part of our vision statement declares that we'll edify one another. Praise God. And so we look forward to those services. And of course, the end of the month, the concert is coming up. We are just looking forward to having a great time in the Lord. Right now, we are in his presence. Amen. Amen. And God has a word for us today. You, someone said, God has a word for us today. God has a word for us today. Praise the Lord. Amen. Your Bible is turned to the book of St. Matthew, chapter 13. And I'd like to read to you from verse 28. To verse 32, St. Matthew chapter 13, let's take from verse 31 to verse 32, Matthew 13, amen. Another parable put he forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which indeed is the least of all the seeds. But when it is grown, it is the greatest among the herbs and become a tree, so that the birds of the air come and lodge in the branches thereof. This is the wording of God's word. Same birds that in verse 4, in verse 4 of chapter 13, the same birds that would have destroyed and picked away them had they fallen by the wayside, same birds now come to lodge in the mustard seed tree. Tell somebody, I am here as a mustard seed. Here is my mustard seed. Here is my mustard seed. And this sermon, this message that God has given to me is not intended to belittle anyone. Amen. Or to reduce you to whatever your ego or your status or your desire may tell you that you are. God knows your size. God knows your fit. God knows your shape. He knows your statistics, your vital statistics. But in the economy of God, in the church of God, in the economy of multiplication and growth, God is saying to us today that our mustard seed will become great if properly placed in the right soil. You see, friend, it's all about the seed. It's all about the seed. The potential lies in the seed. The potential lies in what lies in that little seed. Zechariah chapter 4 and verse 10 tells us something interesting about this beginning small, presenting the small mustard seed then growing into greatness. Zechariah chapter 4. Verse 9 and verse 10, I want to read for you that. The hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of this house. His hand also hath finished it. And thou shalt know that the Lord of hosts has sent me unto you. Verse number 10. For who hath despised the day of small things? For they shall rejoice and shall see the plummet in the hand of the Zerubbabel, which those seven, they are the eyes of the Lord, which run to and fro the whole earth. Run to and fro the whole earth. Here is my mustard seed. Here is my mustard seed. I hope before you leave today, you will get one of these little bags that I have with my diminishing sight. Got a number of mustard seed, and in my own time, took me hours to go through, but in each one, I think I place a mustard seed to show you what a mustard seed is like. A very tiny seed. Yet Jesus told the parable that when it is grown, it grows into a large shrub. Some translation said it's a large tree. Sometimes in some cases between 12 and 15 feet tall. But if you see this mustard seed, when you collect your packet before you leave here today, you'll know it's just a miniature, very tiny. And translators and writers are struggling as to whether it has been the smallest seed of all times. But what do we know? In that part of Palestine, when Jesus told them the story, that was the smallest seed known to the farmers in that time. So I don't care what other kind of engrafted or kind of organic or kind of genetically engineering seed may come now, but at that time, the mustard seed was the smallest to the people of that region. Do not despise small beginnings. Do not limit me also by my smallness or my size. The potential is in the seed. And Jesus over and over and over again chided his disciples and told them, if your faith is like the grain of a mustard seed, you will speak to this mountain. And you'll say, mountain, be thou removed out of this place. In other words, if you're directed aright in your motivation, if you love God, and you live a righteous life, and your faith is properly channeled and properly motivated, nothing is impossible in the hand of a sovereign God.
Amen.
Tell that to every agent on earth. Let the course of hell knows that I believe in God. And I believe that God is a God of small beginnings. And the same God in the small times,
yes,
the same God in the little times will be the same God in the big times. So if your faith is like a grain of mustard seed, he says, you can speak to your mountain.
Yes.
You can, Jesus is talking now.
Yes,
he says it's like the kingdom of heaven, the church, the body of Christ. The body of Christ is like a mustard seed.
Yes, sir.
This is not a guesswork. It's like a mustard seed which a man plants. When he plant that in the soil, the Bible says it grows and grows unto a big tree, a large bush, great shrub, and then birds come and flock into it. The same birds that would have wanted in chapter, in verse 4, to destroy it. The same birds that would have wanted to kill the seed. When they see how much you're growing, how much you're flourishing, how much you're thriving, how much you're not giving up, how much even under pressure you're withstanding it all, the same birds will fly and find pasture and find shelter and find refuge in your mustard tree. So God, here I come today. Here is my mustard seed. Nothing I am in your sight. My faith at best is weak. My limbs are weak. My hope is sometimes shattered. My back is against a wall. But I present to you, Lord, my mustard seed.
Hallelujah.
Here is my mustard seed. Here is my all that I have, everything I have. Here is my potential. Here is my ability. It's wrapped up in one tiny seed. But God, you know. You know what is there. And only you can bring something out of nothing. Only you can bring possibilities out of impossibilities. Do not despise small beginnings.
Amen.
Heard a story about a young lady once who was from the Brooklyn area. She, parents struggled. Fine Christian young lady, parents struggled and sent her off to school. She went to law school and she did very well. She was a Church of God girl, did very well. When she came back, graduated from law school, passed her bar, she was now ready, she got her sermon, got her hood, got her attachments, got everything. Then came a fine young man and proposed to get married to her. But this young man is from one of those larger congregations, big church, stained glass windows, parking lot, and all the rest of it, and everything. True story. A young man says, I want to marry you. Everything checked out fine. Parents check out, that check out. Everything checked out fine. But then came the big question, where will the venue be? Her church was a storefront on Church Avenue. And she's a bride. A storefront on Church Avenue, missionary, and she's a bride. The young man said, but we got parking lot, we got stained glass window, we got all these things. She said, you see, back long before I knew you, them folks in that little storefront church are the ones that prayed me on. They were the ones that encouraged me. Them folks in that storefront church are the ones that held all night prayer meeting when I couldn't pass the bar exam. Those folks are the ones who went down and they prayed for me. Here I am today. I'm not going to let you take me from this place because I understand that God blessed small beginning. And if you can't appreciate where I'm coming from, you can't appreciate where I'm going. You could have two ceremonies. Have the first one in my little storefront church. Let's pack to the hilt. And then have another one in your big sanctuary. But I want you to understand, I will not despise my small beginning. Tell somebody, here's my mustard seed. Here is my mustard seed. Here is my mustard seed. Jesus described the greatness of the church as it were. It is just wrapped in a small packet. Some of the greatest potential that we have with us, you don't see them at first. They come real tiny and small, but do not despise them. Praise God. Stick with it. God will bring you out.
Amen. Your faith might be wavering, but you stick with it. God will bring you out. You might not see the potential, but stick with it. It might be a storefront. It may be a 2x4, but you stay with it. God will bless you. Do not despise small beginning. I'd like to talk to you about some of the small beginnings that we're seeing in Scripture. How God elevated them. Some mustard seed. We'll turn back to the book of Genesis chapter 12. A mustard seed called Abraham. No one knew about him. He was in obscurity. Praise God. In obscurity. With his father and his family in a place called Ur of the Chaldees. We now know it's a place called Turan. Ur of the Chaldees in that heathen land. And God spoke to him in chapter 12 of Genesis. God said, Abraham, get thee out of thy land, from thy kindred, from thy people, to a land which I, God, will show you. Hallelujah, praise God. No roadmap, no sign, no GPS, no nothing at all to map the way. Just a mustard seed faith. Just a mustard seed vision. No navigational system, nothing but just small. Someone says small. There's a place in my childhood that I will never forget. And I may well show it right here in the sermon since I get to it. Many of you know it because I talk about it all the while. When I tell folks where I'm from, they say, where is that? Place don't exist. Hallelujah. But I'll never forget when the Lord called me as a child. I surrendered to Almighty God. And there he placed me in that little country area. And I remember when I was leaving my home to go to college, the saints came and they prayed for me. They laid hand on me. And I remember every trip that I take from my home church to college and I came back, every time I come back, after saying hello to mommy and daddy, the next place I'll go is right at the altar. And I bowed my knees there and said, God, I thank you for the time when you called me. I thank you for raising me up. I thank you for laying your hand upon me in this little rural district. I will not forget nor despise small beginnings. Hallelujah. No, I can't forget it. Because that's where God raised me up. And every time I go back, I would say, God, remember. I remember one time prior to leaving there, things were rough. And unlike you who have choices, we didn't have choices that time. If you don't get that overhead scholarship or that common entrance, you're doomed. You don't go to secondary school or high school, you're doomed. God, as it were, caused me to rise up and I said, God, even I don't have what the other students have. I don't have the kind of money or the kind of education. But if you allow me to enough knowledge to go to college, I will serve you for the rest of my life. I went behind my house and I found a stone. And I took a little stone and I marked on that stone. I said, God, give me enough college knowledge to go through college. God, grant me enough knowledge to go through college. God grant me enough knowledge to go to college. And there I was, like Abraham, like Jacob, with God. We wrestled together. God grant me enough knowledge just to go through college. And every time I go home back to my neighbor, my district, I'll go to the altar in my church and I'll take my little walk up to that stone and look for to see that stone on which I made a vow to God. Well, years have come and gone. They have built a big house over the stone, and the stone is washed away and everything. But I still remember in my heart, amen, when I pledged to Almighty God, when I asked him in my smallness, in my nothingness, when no one knew me, long before marriage or even courtship or children or church, I just said, God, give me enough knowledge. Friends, don't despise small beginnings. hold on and say, present your mustard seed. God, here is my mustard seed. Here is my little faith. I place this in your hand, and God will allow you in due time. If you faint not, he will raise you up. Amen. Abraham was called. God spoke to him. And there are many other persons around him. But Abraham took the bait of salvation, the bait of the call, and it became his mustard seed. It became what he had. And the Bible says that he followed God. Followed God. Listen carefully. Praise God. Listen this carefully. If you follow him with all your heart, based on your faithfulness and on your obedience, God is guaranteed to bless you. I say it again, if you follow him with all your heart, follow God in faithfulness, follow him with all your heart, with your little mustard seed, God will bless you. Amen. Your success is guaranteed. Praise God. If you follow God in your smallness, in your nothingness, God will bring you out. Do not doubt God. Amen. Things are happening in our country now. I'm speaking to the world and those who hear me, people are being afraid now. Some people are panicking. I speak directly to you. I say, don't panic. Trust God. Trust God. I told you a couple weeks ago about my friend who became a theologian, who went on to the seminary in Yale, came here from Jamaica, had nothing, and he was indeed a nobody, and he had nothing. I told you how God helped him, and he said he didn't even have the money to pay tuition, but he got a job as a janitor. And while he was sweeping the room, while he was cleaning, doing the task, he just used the broom as a rhythmic pattern. I know the Lord will make a way for me. I know the Lord will make a way for me. He was sweeping, he was mopping. For if I live this holy life, if I trust in God, hallelujah, I feel God today. If I trust in God and I do what's right, I know the Lord will make a way for me. Friend, it is guaranteed by the hand of God. If I trust in God and I do what's right, if I live this holy life, if I don't fake it, if I don't play church, if I live for God, if I trust him and I do what's right, I know God will make a way. Every door he closed, he open 10 more. Hallelujah. Every door he closes, he opened 10 more. Every opportunity which seemed to have slipped away, God give you 10 more. As long as you remain faithful to him, God will open a door. Here is my mustard seed. Hallelujah. Here's my mustard seed. Fret not. Fret not. Neither be thou envious of the workers of iniquity. Understand this carefully. If you are trusting God fully, God will not let you down. The God whom I serve. Hallelujah. The God whom you serve. The God whom I serve. The God whom you trust will supervise the growth and development of the mustard seed. No birds. No birds. No birds. No fowls. No fowls. No fowls. No fowls. No fowls. No pestilence. Nothing will destroy it. God is God. And he's always. Don't you know he's God? Don't you know he's God? Don't you know he's God? He said, the kingdom of heaven, the church of God, individuals who trust me, people who love me, their faith, their growth, their advancement, their development will be like a mustard seed. Small, miniature. Hallelujah. insignificant, obscure. But when it is grown, hallelujah, when it's grown, it becomes the biggest. Tell somebody, it becomes the biggest. It becomes the biggest. Because God supervised the growth. He told Abraham, Abraham, I will show thee a land. I will show you a land. He said, Abraham, I'll make you a great nation. This time the poor man had nothing but the potential that was there. Just a response. Abraham, in chapter 12, verse 2, I will bless you.
Yes, sir. God.
I will bless you. Abraham, I will bless them that bless you. We're talking about mustard seed. We're talking about mustard seed. Giving it to God. Giving it to God. Giving it to God. Giving it to God. Whatever it is, Lord, I lay before him. Abraham, I will curse them that curse you. Abraham, in thee shall all nations, our God. In thee shall all nations of the earth be blessed. In thy seed shall possess the gates of their enemy. He never had a chick or a child. But in thy seed. In thy seed. Praise the Lord. In thy seed. Why? Because Abraham dared to obey God. Dared to follow him. I said to the church today, obey God. Obey God and leave the rest to him. Trust God and leave your life in his hand. Whether it's sicknesses or difficulty or challenges, trust the Lord and leave the rest to him. She says, Abraham, I am your shield. I am your seal and your exceeding great reward. Oh God, Abraham, you and your son shall be, your son shall be your heir. Abraham, you shall be buried in a good old age. You're going to live long. Glory to God. Despite what doctors say, you're going to live long. You're going to live to a good old age. Hallelujah. Abraham, I'll be the everlasting covenant. Praise God. We are talking about a mustard seed. And you say, well, this was Old Testament. I said, this is Old Testament, all right. But check the record. Yes, sir. Every one of those men and women who come to God, even though it's faintingly, even with fainting hope, even with dazzling hope, and they trust God, and they endeavor to do what is right, God is not a liar.
Amen.
God is not a liar. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. If you trust God and follow his prescription, understand this carefully, you will get large in his presence. He will enlarge your territory. He will increase your boundary. He'll do it financially. He'll do it physically. He'll do it emotionally. He'll do it spiritually. But the greatest thing is you will know it's God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Jesus came on the scene some 4,000 years after bridging that gap, and he began his worldwide movement called the church, the body of Christ. And I love that song, let the church be the church. This mystical movement, amen, created and designed for one purpose in mind, just to save the soul of people, to bring a harbor to those who need God. Listen to me, church is not about sports, nor competition. Church is about the saving of soul. Praise God. We don't come to show our faces. We come to get ourselves right. We come to fix our soul. We come to the repair shop to know that if we are here today and we are gone tomorrow, we can say, and he can say, enter thou. Praise the Lord. We don't come to benefit anybody.
Amen.
If Pastor, he don't see me, he's going to be mad. Yes, I'm going to miss you. I'm going to really look out for you, but that's not the real purpose. The real purpose, my friend, is that you'll get your heart right with God. Because when you die, you must face God. Because man needs God. The soul of man is dying. So Jesus came and he established a church. He established a church, yes. It was Mary's son. Here, John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hebrews chapter 2 verse 14, for as much then as children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that it might, that is the devil, and deliver who through the fear of death were all their lives subject to bondage. He came to conquer death, to bring life for us. Praise God. My friend, the purpose of the church is to bring life. It's to preach Jesus. Praise God. Everything else is a secondary benefit. The purpose of the church is to preach Jesus. That you might know him and know Christ. So Jesus came in obscurity. As a matter of fact, he came from a place called Nazareth. Someone say Nazareth.
Nazareth.
And when one of the disciples heard of him and they asked him where he came from, they says Nazareth. He said, Nazareth? Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Hallelujah. Wow. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? John 1 verse 46. Philip, finding Nathanael, said unto him, we have found him, of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph and Mary. And Nathanael said unto him, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Philip said unto him, come and see.
Yes, sir.
Listen to me carefully. When you look at the fig tree of your life, the mustard seed of your life, the smallness, the insignificantness, the trappings, the vicissitude, and all the problems, not to mention what folks say about you, oh God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. All you can say is, well, come and see.
Come
watch me. Come watch me burn for Jesus. Come watch me live this holy life. Come watch me walk this truth. Come watch me talk this truth. Come watch me live for God. For I am determined. Determined to run. Determined to win. Determined to fight. Hallelujah. Praise God. Can anything good come out of him? Come and see. Glory to God. You heard the testimony of many persons who have been sentenced. God say, well, I'm just giving you 3 days. He's just going down there because of some girl or some boy or some this or some that or some whatever. But you have outlasted the critics. Oh, hallelujah. You have outlived the critics. Hallelujah. And under pressure, your mustard seed still growing. Under difficulty, the mustard still growing. Under hardship, the mustard seed still growing. Hallelujah. Oh, praise God. In difficult time, the mustard seed refused from dying. Because it is planted by God. It's going to go from shore to shore. It is planted by God. If God sends you, he will keep you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Christian faith, my friend, we have now survived 2,017 years since our founder went back to heaven in visible form. But the Holy Ghost is with us. Glory to God. And I believe by the grace of God, the kingdom of God continues to move from shore to shore. Someone said, we're growing.
We're growing.
Dr. Scott write the book like a mighty army. Praise God. Hallelujah. We're growing. Someone say, I'm growing. Tell somebody, I'm growing. Where I was yesterday is not where I am today. Praise God. Hallelujah. I'm growing. Birds are coming, but they are just going to have to go. They can't pick my seed out of the ground because I am planted. Someone say I'm planted. I am planted. I might be small, but I'm planted. You see? And I think about this. I say, you know what? It's a good thing because, you know what? Some of those birds had to overlook you. Because you were so small. You were so insignificant. You had no value in their sight. And they had to work hard to pick you up. But Jesus plants you. Yeah. Says somebody, Jesus plants you. He plants you. Praise God. And having been planted, praise God, there is potential in the seed. There is potential in the seed. Geography, location, social status doesn't define you, my friend. Amen. I am defined by God Almighty.
Amen.
The church of God. I'm defined by the faith I have in Jesus Christ. So wherever I go, whatever I do, I am not afraid to say I am a part of the body of Christ. I am washed by his blood. I am cleansed by his blood. And the problem is, Christianity, the mustard seed, is not confined by circumstances or even by pedigrees. For he could have called great kings, could have called nations that are great, but he chose a few fishermen. Someone say fishermen.
Fishermen.
A few fishermen and a scorned tax collector. Oh God. A few fishermen and a scorned tax collector, and he sent them out. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 26 says, for you see your calling, brethren, how not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty men, not many noble are called, but God hath chosen, say God has chosen, the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. I don't mean to call you a fool, but many times you and I who trust God and trust God fully, people think we are fool. Folks think something wrong with us. But there's nothing wrong with you. If they just can't understand the power of God, the love of God, the grace of God, the holiness of God, something in my heart like a tree. Tell the truth. I came to crisis of faith at one time. And I was questioning. Because they told me that no intelligent boy can go to Clapham Church. They told me you're too intelligent for that stuff. Speaking in tongues and all that. They say you're intelligent. They say you won't find a wife in that church. They told me that. As a matter of fact, I had somebody who agreed to pay my way fully to UTC, full scholarship. If I just say yes to the university, UTC, that was the United Theological Seminary at the time, College of the West Indies, the highest theological school in Jamaica to teach you how to preach, how to form your letters properly, how to, roll your tongue and do the rest of the stuff. Full scholarship paid. But God called me. I was called by God, and I must respond to the heavenly calling. God called me. I don't want to be a professional preacher. I want to be a child of God. And I stuck with it. Yes, I did. By the grace of God, through good encouragement of men and women, I stuck with it.
Amen.
Came to Christ of faith. In the early 70s, I was about to go off to college. And they said, you better go. Because there you will rub hand and rub faces with the elites. And so I got my wings and I flew off to college. And when I got there, you heard this story before, but the young generation will hear it. When I got there, the first couple of days, I was walking across the campus. And someone says, Hey, parson. And I said, oh God, not here. Somebody knows me. That was the beginning of an interaction with the college students. Not only that, but I said that, well, maybe it's just among the student body that there were just the, you know, there's no smart ones. And to make a long story short, God, as it were, networked me with two professors. Back then, these people had their second degree. They were now professors. And they were born again Christian. Speaking in tongues. Holy Ghost filled. Hallelujah. And I said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. I find camaraderie. I find camaraderie. I wasn't stupid. Nobody can mislead me. Listen to me carefully. You don't have to be dumb to be a Christian. You can serve God as an intellectual. You can serve God with education. You can serve God without an education. You can serve God with a job. You can serve God without a job. Do not despise small beginnings. And I learned that education must be subject to your salvation. So I would never use my faith, my education, to manipulate my salvation. Why? Because God is the greatest. To make a long story short, I am purpose in my heart that as long as I can get a student under my arm, I will show them that there's a great combination between spirituality and Christianity. I'll show them that you can get a PhD degree and you can still love Jesus. Amen. You can have a big house and you can still love Jesus. You can make $10 million and you can still love Jesus. You can be a star athlete and you can still love Jesus. You can be a great scholar and you can still love Jesus. Amen. You can have the smallest beginning and you can rise to the top and you can have God use the foolish things to confound the wise. God chose the weak things to confound the strong. God chose those that are nothing to bring together something important. Praise God. Hear what Matthew chapter 6 and verse 30 says. Therefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, oh, you mustard seed? Oh, you have little faith. Why worry when you can pray? Why worry when you can pray? Ask Jesus and he will show you the way. Why worry when you can pray? God is sovereignly in charge. Matthew 8, 24, 26. And behold, there was a great tempest in the sea, inasmuch that the ship was covered with waves, but he was asleep. And the disciples came unto him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. And he says, why are you fearful, O ye of little faith? Then he awoke and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. Listen to me carefully. If your faith is as a grain of a mustard seed and you call on your Jesus, you call on your God in the time of your distress, I don't care how small it is, God will bring you out. There hath no temptation taken you whereby is not common to men. But he with the temptation will make a way to escape. Tell somebody, God will bring you out. The God that we serve will deliver you. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, he will. He will set you free. He will take you out. Praise God. This mustard seed that was sown in the earth began with only 120. It's a lot. It's a big congregation, you know. But compared to what is now happening in the world, millions of people, billions of people, coming to know God. They are knowing him. They are, even as I speak now, in continents of the continent, people are coming to Jesus. This mustard seed continues to grow. It continues to grow. It continues to grow. This mustard seed grow into a worldwide religion, a worldwide faith. Praise God. Now the Bible says, and in the book of Luke chapter 17, the kingdom of God is within you. So I want you to understand, as long as you accept him and you're walking right and you're living right, this growth, this expansion, this growth, this expansion, this explosion is within you. So stop belittling yourself. God knows your name. The kingdom of God is within you. You mean me? Yes, you, brother. You take on his name. You take on his stature. And he's saying, you, and greater works can you do. Will you do than I do? Because I'm leaving you with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. We have more than 120 in this crowd. Yes. Isn't that true? Yes, and when Christ was here for 3.5 years of public ministry, yes, there were just 120 of them, yes, and a few women. But God says greater.
Yes, sir.
Someone say greater.
Greater.
Listen to me carefully. For the last 33 years, we've been preaching this message. And I will never relegate this to that. There's greater things. There are greater things. As you take this message to your generation, you can reach more people than we've reached in 33 years. How many of us know that? Our preaching right now is doubling every day. Why? Because God is giving us the facility to meet others. Everybody in this place, almost all of you here, some of you have Facebook, and you may have 10 or 15 Facebook friends. And if you just put the topic of this sermon,
amen,
on your Facebook,
right,
to the glory of God,
amen,
just put one word, one sentence from this sermon that affects you. Already I'm preaching to 50 people,
right,
outside of here.
Yes, sir. That's true.
Outside of here. So greater work will be accomplished,
amen,
by the next generation than what we've accomplished. But you've got to live right. You've got to walk right. You've got to back up the message. Your life must back up the message. Because you can't preach unless you live. And you've got to live to preach. You've got to live for God. Or else they will not believe your message.
That's right, sir. That's right.
This kingdom must grow. The mustard seed continues. The mustard seed continues. It continues from obscurity into a powerful army. Listen this carefully. We have not yet scratched the surface of the impact of this mustard seed. God didn't just save you to sit down like that. We have not yet scratched the impact of this. Oh, Pastor, I'm getting old. And my bones are weak. Mine too. But I'm going to preach a strong Jesus. A Jesus which has potential. A Jesus which even in his dying days still proclaim.
Amen.
I think about Moses. I think about Joseph.
Right.
And Joseph told his brethren, said, listen, you are coming down to Egypt. You're coming down to Egypt. But I want you to understand this. You're going to multiply. You're going to be a great army. And when you're going out, take my bones with you. In other words, he saw the impact. Hallelujah. He saw the impact. He saw the mustard tree. He saw the flourishing. And he knew a time will come when the people, the same 70 people that came down, will march out like a mighty army. Glory to God. 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 Someone say mustard seed. Your impact must go farther than you. If all you're doing is building your own nest egg, you have problems. But when you shall have gone, the impact, think about throwing a pebble in the water, and it makes a ripple.
Yes, sir.
and the ripple, and the ripple, and the ripple, and the ripple, and the ripple. Praise God. And so God says, this mustard seed is like a tree that is going to grow, is going to fill the whole earth. Yes. And here's the point. Some of those men whom he was speaking to never even realized until he was gone about how much they would have to pay to see the growth and the development of the mustard seed. Are you ready for this? Are you ready for this? Your Christian faith must cost you something. You can't be on the surface and be a cutesy salvation person. It must cost you something. It must cost you some friends. It must cost you some fame. It must cost you some popularity. It might even cost you your life. I know I'm preaching right. I know I'm preaching right. This faith must cost you something. It's a mustard seed. It's growing to the next level. Not everybody gonna like you.
That's right.
You're gonna have some enemies from without and enemies within. Birds gonna call. Oh God. You see, because I couldn't get you in verse 4. Now that you start to flourish, guess where they're gonna come? They're gonna come after your head. They're gonna perch on you. And they're going to even mess in your tree. But shake them off. Tell somebody, shake them off. Shake them off. Shake them off. Let them fly. They're going to come. They're going to want shelter. They're going to want food. They're going to even perch in your tree. They're going to even mess in your tree. But I said, you must not say, go. Flourish. 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 They can't kill you because you're already growing. Hallelujah. Flourish. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, and his leaves shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like a chaff. Oh, hallelujah. Which the wind driveth away. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth. The Lord knoweth the way of the righteous. But the way of the ungodly shall perish. She fly. She birds. Get away, birds. Let my mustard tree glow. Let my mustard tree grow. You couldn't get me when I was a little root, when I was a seed, before I was incubated. Now I'm incubated. You can't get me again. In the name of Jesus, you come too late. You come too late. You perch too late. You perch too late. Infancy is over. Praise God. Now Jesus says it will grow. It will grow like a mustard tree. We talk about the impact. We talk about the impact. And the price some of us have to pay. Poor Peter, he never knew. But according to history, Peter was crucified, as Jesus predicted, he was crucified upside down. Praise God. Andrew was crucified. Also, Matthew became a missionary to Ethiopia. When he got to Ethiopia, the Ethiopians spear him with a spear. They drove a spear through him. But yet that did not shake the mustard tree. The church continued to grow. Oh, church of God, mother of the free, she continued on to grow. Bartholomew, who was also called Nathaniel, he was martyred in Athens. In Armenia. He was martyred in Armenia. Thomas, remember Thomas? The doubting Thomas. God sent him to India. He landed at a place called Kerala in India. And there God allowed him to to begin the church in India. But hallelujah, as he preached the gospel, someone stabbed him to death. He gave his life for the propagation of the gospel. Him who could not believe, did not believe until he saw the wounds, got a wound for his life. We talk about impact. We talk about impact. Philip's death was exceedingly cruel. He was impaled by iron hook. They hook him in his ankle. Turn him upside down. And there he was. But one writer writing in the early Christian church says, the seed, the blood of the martyrs became the seed of the church. The blood of the martyrs became this. Listen to me carefully. The more they fight against you, the more you must live right. The more they fight against you, the more you must prove them wrong. Tell them in Jesus' name, you will not backslide. In the name of Jesus Christ, you will not, don't give them the opportunity to rejoice over you. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty where Christ hath made you free, and be not again entangled in the yoke of bondage. Walk right, live right, walk clean, live clean. The more they talk about you, it's the more you grow. It's the more you grow. Philip was hung upside down, but the blood of the martyrs became the seed of the church. James, the son of Zebedee, was beheaded by the king, Herod. Herod chopped off his head, but the blood of the martyrs became the seed of the church. The more they fight against you and your church and your God and your faith, it's the more you must grow. Stay on your knees. Prove the birds wrong. I said, prove the birds wrong. Live to shelter them. Live to shelter them. Live to give a resting place to them. When they are confused, when they are perplexed, they're going to want a place to perch. Be there. Jude, who wrote the book, last book before Revelation, he went all the way to Persia. Persia. And there in Persia, he was crucified by the Magi. Same group of folks they call wise men who didn't know God at the time, but they crucified Jude. Some of you will have to take the gospel far and wide. Far-flung cities, but this kingdom must grow. This mustard seed must flourish. James, the less, amen, was thrown from the pinnacle of the temple. They brought him over there and showed him the temple and said, you don't recant your faith. We're going to throw you down. And James said, throw me down, brother. There must be something right about God. These men weren't fools. These men gave their lives. Come on, church of God. You are too skin deep. Get deeper. Set your faith like a flint. Praise God. Plant your root and say to yourself, in this multiculture where everything goes, if I perish, I perish. But I must see the king. I'm living for God. The devil is not compromising for you. No. They won't listen to your prayer. They won't come to your church. They won't even go to dinner with you. They won't come to your party. They won't come to your concert, so why are you going to mess around with their stuff?
That's right, sir.
Why are you lowering your flag for them?
That's right.
They are not lowering their flag for you.
Amen.
Be a mustard seed. Amen. Grow. Amen. Grow. God is counting upon you.
Yes, sir.
They know how to wait you out. Because someday you'll break. But let me tell you something. This is the church of God. And Jesus says, upon this rock, I'll build my church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail. Hallelujah. Hey, glory to God. The gates of hell
shall not prevail.
Simon, Andrew's brother, was crucified. James, the brother of Jesus, was thrown off a wall to his death. And this was done after he refused to recant. And disciple after disciple, patriarch after patriarch, they died that this gospel must be preached. This mustard seed that you're carrying, this potential you're carrying called Christianity, called the kingdom of God, is not confined. It didn't start with you. Let me say it again. It didn't start with me. It didn't start with me, and it will not end with me. It didn't start with you, and it won't end with you. Because if you refuse to shine, God will raise up. I told this to Ruth. He says, listen to me, Ruth. If you sit there in the palace, Esther, sorry, you sit there in the palace and think you're going to make it because of your beauty and your fashion, and God raise up somebody else and bring deliverance to the people, you have no part in this business. So you better get involved now. Praise God. Tomorrow might be too late. But today is the day of salvation. Jump in the waters now. Serve God now. Do it now. The kingdom of God needs you now. Amen. Pastor, I'm waiting until I get married. God may not call you into marriage. I hope he does. I pray he does. I'm believing God for you, but he might not call you into marriage. And as a matter of fact, I tell my story. I said, listen, when a husband or a wife comes to look at you, they must see you serving God. Yeah. And if they are successful in pulling you away from God, you weren't in anything at all. They got to respect the fact they are serving God. Praise the Lord. They must find you worshiping God. They must find you on your knees. When the enemy come to look for you, they must find you on your knees. Praise God. Sometime when the phone is ringing, you can stay. Don't answer it. Stay on your knees.
Amen,
one dear mother, one day, she, mother of her brother in this church, she says, out of order. Don't they know I'm praying? How could they want to interrupt my time with the Lord? I am praying. I'm talking to God now. Don't call me when I'm talking to God. I wish we had some more folks who would say that.
That's right, sir.
This is the time with me and God now. It's my devotion. Ah, come on, church. Phone ringing, church, and you get up and you excuse me, you're gone. Phone ringing, church, and you put up your excuse me finger and you're gone. God is talking to you. Don't do that. Turn the phone off. It's me and God now. You got me all this while. Talk to me right now. It's me and Jesus. My Lord is talking to me now. I'm getting something from him. Right now, I'm in tune with God, so leave me alone. Let me talk to my Jesus. Friendship with Jesus. Fellowship divine. Oh, what blessed sweet communion. Let me talk to my God. It's right now me and Jesus. Dear friends, I want to encourage you today. Live your lives to impact. Yes. The result of this impact, the number one, birds will come flocking after you. Some good birds, some bad birds. But you got to know how to shake them off.
Yes,
you got to know how to shake them off. It's not every bird is bird. Some birds come just to leave their mess. Tell the truth. Some birds just come to leave their mess.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. But some birds come to take the pollen from this tree and to go over there and to repopulate and to spread and to help you grow. But some birds come just to destroy you. You got to watch them birds. You got to watch them birds. You got to know them birds. Understand them birds. Holy Ghost, help me today. Tell somebody, watch them birds. Know them birds. Some of them birds just come to mess up your tree.
Yes, sir.
Live a faithful life, church. Don't fake it. Don't fake it. Let your heart and your life be genuine. Your impact will go farther than you may think. And I got news for you. You might think you're small and you're miniature and you're insignificant, but God knows your worth. God knows your kingdom value. God knows your word. Be obedient to God and follow him. I want to summarize this impact to the kingdom that Jesus had and then close. Found a point which you all know. Some more than 2,000 years ago, there was a man that was born contrary to laws of life. This man lived in poverty and was reared in obscurity. He did not travel extensively like you and I. Matter of fact, never had a visa, never had a green card. Never lived in the metropolitan city of the world. Only once did he cross the boundary of his territory, and that was when he was exiled during his infancy. He possessed neither wealth nor influence. His relatives were inconspicuous. And he neither had training in formal education nor in informal. In infancy, he startled the king. In childhood, he puzzled the doctors. In manhood, he ruled the course of nature. Walked upon the billows as if it were a pavement. And hushed to sleep the deep sea. He healed the multitude without medicine and made no charge for his service. He never wrote a song, yet he furnished a theme of more than all the songwriters combined together. He never founded a college, but all the schools put together cannot boast of having more students than he had. He never practiced medicine, no, not once. Never been to medical school, yet he has healed more broken hearts than every doctor, both far and near. Every seventh day of the week, wheels of commerce cease and they're turning, and multitudes wind their way to worship him in assemblies and to pay homage to him and pay him respect. Names of past and proud statesmen of Greek and Rome have come and gone. The names of past scientists and philosophers and theologians have come and gone. The name of this man abounds still more and more and more. Though time has passed more than 2,017 years ago between that time and now, this generation still sees him as Jesus Christ. Herod could not kill him. The grave could not hold him. He stands in heavenly glory and proclaims himself as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. His name is Jesus. Down from the glorious realm of heaven he came into the obscure womb of a virgin. Glory to God. And today he has boasted more souls than anyone else. His name is Jesus. You're mustard seed. You're a mustard seed. You're a mustard seed. It might be small and miniature and inconsistent and insignificant and obscure, but you can grow. Amen. And you can fill your neighborhood. Hallelujah. You can fill your Facebook. You can fill your page. You can fill your friends with the message of Jesus Christ. Because we are the church of the living God. Hallelujah. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. You cannot join her. You must be born in her. You cannot join her. You must be born in her. She is the glorious church of God, begun in obscurity. But one day, all the world will be gathered together. And they will crown him King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Can you see him, my brother, marching out this glorious church, gathering his army of people without spot or wrinkle? Let me ask a question as I close. Are you in the church? Are you a part of this mystical union? Are you blood washed, born again? Living right, walking clean, or you faking it? I trust today that if you are here, you'll give him your mustard seed. Amen. Just as I am. Little, miniature, doubtful, hopeful, hopeless, uncertainty, sick, pale, whatever the negative you can use, but you know this, that if your faith is like a grain of mustard seed, you'll speak to your mountain. Could the church stand? Everybody please stand. Hallelujah. You won't take that course. She's spreading her wings for a journey. She's going to take by and by. When the great trumpet sound in the morning, she'll meet her dear Lord in the sky. And you know, I like us to sing it in the old-fashioned way. Are you part of this mystical body? Are you ready for the rapture? Are you ready to say, Lord, I'll be an impact? This glorious union with God will take place. Sing one verse. We gather at the altar for prayer. Glory to God. Go ahead with me, please. Or whatever the verse or chorus, whatever it is. Amen.
What beautiful thought I am thinking. Amen. Concerning the great spangled bird. Remember her name is recorded on the pages of God's holy word. All the other birds talking around her, and she is despised by her swan.
Surrender before the Lord. Raise those hands together as an act of surrender. Lord Jesus, here is my mustard seed, my potential, my ability. Everything within me, God, spells nothing in your sight. But Lord, when you take my nothingness, you can make something great. My weak faith can become strength. My sickness can become my healing, my health. Oh God, where I am fearful, place doubt. Place hope. Where I am doubtful, place faith. Father, where I fall, cause me to stand. In the name of Jesus, I pray for your son. I pray for your daughter. At this sacred altar now, Lord, I wave my hand over this congregation, over the people of God. Lord, it's not by might nor by power. Your word alone gives hope and strength in their lives. Those who are dealing with situation, God, sometimes they get weak.